We're talking about the family this week, the home, and what the Bible teaches about it. If there's ever been a time when there needs to be preaching on the home, folk, we're living at that time. We need to be studying the Word of God. We need to be making our homes better. And so tonight, we want to think about some folders on the family. Now, these are God's folders. You know, God keeps folders, records. He knows what's going on. He's the great planner. And we used to have the old file cabinets. Some of you will remember those. Now we have computers. We don't have to use that. But we used to go through those filing cabinets, and I could never find anything. I had a filing system that only I could work, and I couldn't work it either most of the time. But that's the way we did it. And God has folders on the family. And we want to investigate and look inside of those folders, and those are some of the lessons we're going to be looking at. And tonight, I want us to think about some of the layers of the family. That is building blocks, so to speak, where you have things that are fitting up on top of each other, that are crucial, that are important, and we must have them if we're going to be what God wants us to be and our families the way we want them to be. Now, I'm going to take our study tonight from Proverbs 31. Someone says, well, I think that deals with the virtuous woman. Well, it does. But do you know there are principles in that, and sometimes we miss things because of the glasses that we read the Bible through. And so sometimes we'll read Proverbs 31, and especially us guys, and we'll see this applies to the woman. This has nothing to do to me. I remember one preacher said one time, I love preaching to the women. It's the only sermon I got that I don't have to fit me with. Well, that's not true. You see, because the principles many times that are set out are very important. And we see that so much in this great chapter written by Solomon, who had had his share of problems and difficulties and realized, if anyone ever did, how important that the family was. Now watch this. The Bible says, who can find a virtuous woman? Her price is far above rubies. The heart of her husband does safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeketh wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands. She's like the merchant ships. She bringeth her food from afar. She riseth up also while it is yet night, giveth meat to her household and a portion to her handmaidens. So she considereth a field and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hands she planteth a vineyard. She girdeth her loins with strength and strengtheneth her arms. She perceiveth that her merchandise is good. Her candle goeth not out by night. She layeth her hands to the spindle, and her hands hold the distaff. She stretcheth out her hand to the poor, yea, she reacheth forth her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. She maketh herself coverings of tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple. Her husband is known in the gates, when he sitteth among the elders of the land. She maketh fine linen and selleth it, and delivereth girdles unto the merchants. Strength and honor are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in time to come. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household. She eateth not of the bread of idleness. Her children rise up, and they call her blessed. Her husband also praiseth her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain. But a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Isn't that a marvelous reading from the Word of God? And ladies, what a beautiful section of Scripture that has been devoted to you, and that stresses the beauty of womanhood, and how important you are to your husband, and to your children, and to the church, and to the community where you live. You are special. And therefore we honor you, because you deserve that honor and respect. And Solomon here said, here's your virtuous woman. Now, he also pointed out that it can be difficult at times to find a virtuous woman. I don't believe that he means by that that it's, you know, seldom that you're going to see that, but the fact when you compare that to the large portion of women in the world, they would be few in that comparison. But we realize, all of us that have been in the Lord's church very long, how important our ladies are and how valuable they are to us. And I want to take three things from our study tonight, and I want us to look at that and how that is so important, layer upon layer, for my marriage and my family to be successful. And so much of what is in the section of scriptures that we have just read gives insights to the qualities of a great home. And we want to consider trust, toil, and tenderness. And we find all three of those in this reading. And I want you to think about it, because you weigh these things in light of your own life. You know, what we have to do is take our Bibles and we read them and we study them with great diligence, but we must make the personal application. No one can do that for you. That's something that you have to do. That's something that I have to do as well. And so a lot of times when there's a breakdown in the home, the fella or the lady that acts as if it's really not his or her problem, it's their mate's, may be looking through rose-colored glasses. See, it may be the case they're the one that needs the help. I remember the story told one time of a fella that lived in this community, and his three little children, when it got time for daddy to come home, would run to the window and they would stick their nose up against the window pane and they would anxiously look for daddy. Now, mama had to warn them, because they would run out and when they saw the car coming, and she'd say, "Now you just sit still till daddy's in the yard and the car's turned off and you'll be fine." And they would run out, and of course they were jumping on daddy and he was holding them up, and they were just so excited to see daddy come home every afternoon. Across the street, there were three little children as well. And they too would put their nose against the pane of the window and they would watch for daddy to come. And when his car came across the curve or around the curve, they headed for cover, because you see, they were afraid of daddy. Daddy had built barriers that only daddy could tear down. The problem wasn't with the wife, and the problem was not with the children. The problem was with daddy, but he thought the problem was with everyone else. You see, if there's barriers between you and your wife or you and your children, there's a good possibility you built those barriers, and only you can tear them down. And so we have to be honest. Judgment day, honest, when it comes to our families. And so we want to think about these three insights that we read from the virtuous woman. Number one, trust. Look at what the Bible said. The heart of her husband does safely trust. He trusts in her. And so that he shall have no need of spoil, she will do him good and not evil all the days of his life. She doesn't know it. You, of course, did not know it. But many, many times at night I would reach over and put my hand on Betty and thank God she was laying there and I didn't have to wring my hands wondering, wonder where she is. Wonder what time she'll come home. Wonder who she's with. Never had to do that. One of our elders at C Street, Brother George Ellis, said any man that knows where his wife is like that ought to thank God every day for his wife, because a lot of guys can't say that. You see, trust is important in a relationship. And if Betty can't trust me or I cannot trust her, then we've got troubles in our marriage. We've got troubles in the home. And so trust is very important. And this passage of Scripture in Proverbs 31, 11, and 12 is, as it were, picking up this word trust and holding it up in capital letters and saying, put this in your home. Trust one another. Build a relationship on trust and everything will be better. And so we have to put this trust in our marriage and how important that is. And so the Bible emphasizes the fact that we must have this trust. A foundation principle of successful marriages in the home, of course, is from this word, trust. Now think about it. strong confidence in the credibility of the words or the vows that were made the day the two became one is without parallel importance. I take you to be faithful in sickness and in health, for richer, for poorer, till death do us part. Those are vows that we made. I was discussing the Bible with a friend of mine over in the state of Kentucky. And he said, you know, but a lot of these people, Eddie, that become Christians, they didn't understand what the Bible taught about marriage, divorce, and remarriage. And so they were maybe married and divorced, remarried four or five times, and they didn't understand that. I said, did they understand their marriage vow? Did they understand that when they said that they're taking their mate for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness, in health, until death do us part? I understood that. Neither Betty and I were Christians when we got married, and we didn't know what the Bible taught about marriage, divorce, and remarriage, but we knew what we just vowed to each other, till death do us part. And it's a wonder she hadn't killed me already. Thank God she hasn't. But till death do us part. Did they understand those vows? I asked a guy one time. He was getting married for about the fifth time, and every one of his wives he had left for not scriptural grounds. And I said to the lady, I said, how can you trust this guy? When he looks you in the eye and says, I'm going to take you for better, worse, sickness and health, to love and to cherish, to death do us part. And he's already said that five other times and didn't keep his promise. You know, how many times does it take? See, God says you've got to put that trust in your relationship. And when that trust is there, you see the importance that is involved in it. And here, the inspired word of God lifts up these beautiful passages talking about a virtuous woman and says something about her husband and her relationship. It's built on trust. He trusts her. He knows that he can depend upon her. And it's tragic to see a husband who is controlling and suspicious of his wife's every word and every step. I know a guy that couldn't keep a job because he couldn't trust his wife. Now, he could trust her, but he didn't think he could. And he had to be somewhere every day where he could look through his binoculars to see who was going in and out of that house when no one was going in or out of that house. No trust. Can you imagine how miserable his life had to be, that he could never feel any sense of confidence or trust that his wife is faithful and loyal to him and to him and him alone? And so, unfortunately, he could not do that. And so it's sad to see that kind of thing happening. And so having a mutual confidence in each other, from each other, is a peace that every marriage should be able to experience and to enjoy. Now, if that trust is not in your marriage, it's not there because you haven't put it there, and only you can do something about that. Only I could do something about that. And so we have to realize how important this trust really is. Equally as damaging is the wife's probing into every action of her husband. You know, and you watch some of these shows on TV, and I'm a good scanner. Man, I mean, I can watch 40 shows at one time. I don't know what the record is. And you'll scan through there and all of a sudden something will catch your attention. But one of the things that catches my attention, these sometimes you'll go through and one of these talk shows will be on and the woman says, oh, now I get my husband's cell phone and I go through that cell phone and I see who he's calling and I look and see who he's on the internet with. And what she's saying is, I don't trust him any further than I could throw him. And I've got to search everything to know, to make sure that he is not sneaking around and doing stuff he shouldn't be doing. Her life has to be miserable. Her life has to be miserable. I personally don't have to worry about that. Betty doesn't know how to turn a cell phone on. She finally the other day got a computer. I like to have a major heart attack. A little computer. And she plays games on it. She wants to look up recipes. I don't think she's looked up many recipes. She don't know how. She'll get on something and she cannot get off of it. But anyway, that's another sermon. Sorry, honey, I didn't mean to get off on that one. But can you imagine someone that cannot trust their mate, that they've got to constantly be going through stuff. But you see, trust allows each to have a way from each other in different activities of the day, and yet knowing all of that time, everything is exactly the way it ought to be. I don't have to follow Betty around. I would trust her any place, any time, or anywhere. And that's the way a marriage ought to be built, built upon trust. And so when we have that trust in our marriage, then we're going to have a better marriage. And so it's not by accident in Proverbs 31 that Solomon would emphasize the trust of a relationship and the importance of it. But now, also involved in this chapter, you may have noticed it as I was reading it, a number of times the idea of toil is mentioned. Marriages don't happen, just happen chance, to be successful. That's not the way it works. If you're going to have a successful marriage, you have to plan it. You have to work at it. And so if you don't do that, then you're not going to have a successful marriage. It's just not going to be. And so this toiling goes on both sides, both with the male and the female. And when each person is toiling, working, laboring to make his and her relationship what it ought to be, and making sure especially that they personally are doing the right thing, it's going to make it better. Now notice, she looketh well to the ways of her household and eateth not of the bread of idleness. Now you go over in the New Testament, there were some women over there that were busybodies in other people's matters. Quite the opposite of the picture of Proverbs 31. But you see, the point we're making tonight is that here is this virtuous woman, and she's not just saying, well, boy, we got all these children now. I wonder how we're going to take care of them, and we got this going on and that going on. She looked to the ways of her household. Now, what have I got to do? What have I got to do to make this successful and work? And so there was some toiling that had to be involved. This section is filled with words of productive labor. She seeketh, she worketh willingly, she planteth a vineyard. Now, I'm not a farmer. My wife loves to plant stuff and grow stuff. She and our oldest son have a landscaping business and a mowing business. She can take a weed eater and kill about any man in here. And I don't mean with the thing, I mean working with it, okay? And she'll plant those flowers in the yard. I was showing some last night, a picture of a house, and it's just a picture. And she loves it. Have you got any idea how much work goes into that? That stuff, it don't just grow on its own. Did you know that? It took me a while to learn that. It don't just grow. Weeds do, but those flowers do not. And that garden and the beautiful food out of it that I love to eat, she spends time hoeing and working and doing the things in that garden. And so you look at that and you see here's someone that is busy toiling to make it better. But not just doing stuff, but doing things that matter. Doing things that make a difference in the home. To make the home and the family a place where you want to go and where you want to be, not some place you want to run away from. And so the home, and putting this toil in it. And so she seeketh and she worketh willingly and she plants a vineyard. You see, she's looking well to the ways of her household, and she don't have time to do that and be idle. Remember the parable the Lord told of the casting out of the demon, and it was swept and garnished, but nothing was put back. And so the demon come back with seven demons even worse. You see, when we become Christians, we empty ourselves of that old man, but we got to put that new man in there. We got to realize that there's some toiling and work that has to be done to make me the kind of Christian that I need to be. And so I'm going to look to the future, and I'm going to plan, and I'm going to put my hands to the plow, and I'm not going to look back, and I'm going to busy myself being a faithful child of God and the best husband or wife that I can be. Toiling, working. Now, I don't know how many times I've used this in funerals, talking about a faithful, dedicated Christian lady that had meant so much to my life, but really missed some of the crucial ingredients that had to be there in our families and not just in a person's individual life. And so we have to employ this idea of understanding that things just don't happen. A casual look into the life of this woman should show that She had no time to be idle with all of the production that she gave. She worked for the present needs and she prepared for future ones. Give her of the fruit of her hands and let her own works praise her in the gate. Thought of Dorcas when I read that. When she died, they were sitting there admiring the work that she had done while she was with them. That meant so much to those people on that occasion. Here she is. And when she's working and she's doing the things that she should be doing, the God of heaven says, give her of the fruit of her hands and let her own works praise her in the gates. And when all are working together for the good of the home, a great home is produced. Just like when you plant the garden and you do all the work and you enjoy the beautiful flowers or the good food that comes out of the garden. It's good. You're seeing the fruit of your labors and the work of your hands. And it's even better when it's applied spiritually. And our homes have a beautiful place. And therefore we see that here is a great home that is being produced. Building a home takes much labor. And if without this labor, as we read in Proverbs 14:1, we cannot have the kind of home that's going to be pleasing to God. Every wise woman buildeth her house, but the foolish plucketh it down with her hands. You just think of the people tonight who think they're building successful homes that will be plucked down. Except the Lord build the house, we talked about this morning. They labor in vain that build it. You see, you just can't do it with your own wisdom and human ingenuity. It won't work. You got to turn your life over to God. And here the Bible's very clear about it. But a wise woman is building a house. She's not building a physical structure. She's building a house, a home that any man would love to live in. What a blessing that is when we see the toil and the labor that is involved in it. And then our last word, tenderness. Tenderness. Now guys, we need to learn some sermons about tenderness. We need to learn some principles about tenderness, especially in the home, and employ them. You know, a lot of times our attitude is rough and rugged. Boy, look at these calloused hands. Well, don't look at these calloused hands, but look at calloused hands. I'm rough and I'm the rugged type. Well, you need to be tender-hearted. You see, some of the most rugged men I've ever known, a real man's man, have been men that had hearts as tender as the universe on which we live. Tender-hearted. And you know, we can learn a lot about tender-heartedness from Jesus, can we not? How tender-hearted he was. And what he was willing to do and the price he was willing to pay because he cared about the people that he dealt with. No home is great where compassion is absent. You can't have a great home and take compassion and set it outside the door. If that compassion is not there, the home will never be as great as it could be. It is stated of this worthy woman, she openeth her mouth with wisdom, and her tongue is the law of kindness. Should it not be the case that the law of our tongues are kindness as well? I wonder how many more members of the Lord's body we might have tonight if we were a little bit more tender sometimes and compassionate toward those that are lost. I don't know. I'm just asking. But you see, tenderness, compassion is so important. In Proverbs 31, in verse 20, she is compassionate to those unfortunate ones that are outside her home. Can you not see that compassion don't just stay within the confines of four walls? Compassion is something that goes everywhere you go, or else it does not. Compassion is something that we demonstrate and we live in our lives. A number of years ago, been more than I'd like to think now, I guess, but we had a flood. It wasn't a humongous flood by any means, but 8 people lost their lives. One of the ladies that was a member of the church at C Street lost both her mom and dad in that flood. And so it was a tragedy for our little area. And there were people that were debating over if you could help somebody outside the church or not with the finances of the church. And there was all kinds of wranglings going on. And I thought, this community doesn't care how much we know till they know how much we care. And so we got our bottles of water and our little food bags together, and we went from door to door and house to house trying to help folks who lost everything. Everything that they physically possessed, gone. And you know, you can replace stuff, but you can't replace a mom and dad. You can build back a house, a structure, but you can't build back a mom and dad. Some people lost some, and some people lost all. But we needed to be there as a body of people that said to them, we love you. That's why we're here. Let us help you. And then from that, we could help them spiritually as well. And we had some that obeyed the gospel through the efforts. If we'd have just had one, that would have been more than enough. And if we'd have had none, we'd still been doing what God wanted us to do. Demonstrate compassion. Let the community where you live and work and worship know that you care about them. You care about their struggles. You see, and that's why so many homes have gone astray, is because we don't care. We don't have any compassion. And if I don't have it in my home, I'm not going to have it anywhere. Nowhere is it going to be found if I remove it from my very family that I ought to love more than anything in the world and love God even more than them. But you see, the tenderness has got to be there. And so she had compassion. And she had compassion to the unfortunate ones on the outside. Paul said, listen, I was working, worshiping with the church at Ephesus, and God said, I want you to remember the poor. Paul would later write, as you have opportunity, do good to all men, and especially those of the household of faith, Galatians 6 and 10. You see, kindness, tenderness, compassion that we need to have demonstrated in our lives, all of it found in this beautiful passage. So showing mercy and kindness is to be close to the character of God Himself. In Titus 3, 4, and 5, God is caring and compassionate. That's a characteristic of deity. And so the more compassionate I am, the more like God I become. And that's important to us. And so we learn that love and tenderness is to be sought after in the home more than the material riches and things of this life. Watch what Solomon said. Better is a dinner of herbs with little than a stalled ox with hatred therewith. I'd rather eat the crumbs that fall from the table and have love than the finest steaks in the world where there's bitterness and hatred and the things that destroy lives. Better is a dry morsel and quietness therewith than a house that is filled with sacrifices, but with strife as well. You see, Solomon's trying to say, folks, listen, turn the little light switch on now and get this thing right. I messed up so many times, it's not funny, and I don't want you to do the same thing. Get this right. And if you get it right, you won't have to go through the struggles, a lot of the struggles and difficulties that I personally, Solomon said, would have to go through. If you'll get it right, fear God, keep His commandments. This is the whole of man. Do it, and you'll be glad you did. Don't follow my bad example. Listen to the good words that God has given me that I have experienced to be true in my life. And we need to heed those words. That it's better to have little and have love than to have much with strife and the things that are going to destroy your life. Since the Lord made the home to be a blessing to humanity, it should follow that the Lord knows best what the home needs. He knows better than I do. If I'd have written the book, it'd have been all messed up, but it wouldn't have had what some of the things God says in it. And it would have been a mess, and you'd have read my book, and you'd have followed my principles, and you'd have said, I'd like to get my hands on that little rascal. He has messed up my life. God is the builder of the home. He instituted it in the Garden of Eden, and he knew from then and even before then and to now what we need to survive in our homes if we'll just listen. Would that home be a taste of heaven on earth? Ben McKnight wrote a book many, many years ago entitled The Home is the Vestibule of Heaven. I don't know if you ever read it or not, but it's a good book. The home is the vestibule of heaven. Vestibule, heaven. What a beautiful thing that is. God instituted that home, and now he's gone to prepare another home that's even going to be better than the home we have now. He knows how to build a home, doesn't he? All we have to do is listen to him and let him help us to know what is right. Now, the layers of the home are so important when it comes to pleasing God Almighty. Can these be found in your home? Now, again, I don't know. You don't know what's in my home or not, but God does. It could be that you look at this and you say, well, you know, I don't have a real problem with trust or even tenderness for that matter, but maybe as a wife, I'm not quite working as much as I need to be working to make this home better. Or the husband may say, well, you know what? That's not just a problem with you. That's something I've got to work on. I've got to look at this thing, take my Bible and look at the home as God has it, and work as hard as I can day and night to make sure that I fill it with work and time. It takes time to build a home. And unfortunately, we're spending our time somewhere else most of the time. And that's sad. And very little time in trying to build that home. Trust, toil. And fellas, we might have to work on a little tenderness. Maybe not. I've known some men that were the most tender people in all the world. And that's great. That's a trait of God. Nothing wrong with it. And so we ought to have that tenderness. Now, I've got to look at this lesson tonight. And I've got to look at my wife, and I've got to ask, what kind of husband am I? And I promise you, more times than not, it's this guy that's got to do a little bit more work to make our home even better. We mentioned this morning we've been married 47 years. That's right, isn't it? That's what she tells me. I'd rather ask her than get it wrong. But you see, we're still working on that home. We're still toiling. We're still growing. We're still learning. We're still finding out what we need to find out to even make it better. And this time, 20 years from now, if we're still living and our home still exists, it should be a lot better then than it even is now. And that's hard to imagine. But you see, it becomes better as we work on that home. Now, if you're not a Christian, you got to become a Christian before you can really make this home work. And that begins by hearing the Word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. That leads you to a belief system, as we have on the screen for you tonight, and you can't read that maybe as well where you may be sitting, but believe, John 8, verse 24. Repent, Luke 13 and 3. Make that good confession that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, Matthew 10, 32, and then be baptized for the remission of your sins to put Christ on, and then remain faithful. Remain faithful to God, and as long as you are faithful to God, you will be faithful one to another. And so it starts with our relationship, my relationship with deity, and how I love him and care for him as he loves and cares for me. I hope that our study tonight has been helpful to you, and I hope that you have the greatest home that can be enjoyed upon the face of this earth. You ought to love your home, and you ought to spend more time there than anywhere else. Steve Jobs once said, It's sad to have a job you don't love, because you'll spend more time doing that than anything else. And I think it's hard for me to conceive having a home that you couldn't love and would not want to be there. So God help us to build our home.